All right, let's get started. Hello and welcome to SolarCon 2020, the open source event dedicated to advancing standards and technologies in data and storage. My name is Anvit KS, and I'm going to be the master of ceremonies, the maitre d', if you will, for the day and for the next 2 days here. This is the first edition of SolarCon 2020, and we are very glad that you're part of this momentous occasion. Virtual events are the new normal now. And we are very glad that participants from over 45 countries have registered for this event. With over 50 speakers, over 25 organizations, 2 days, 10 hours, 4 keynote sessions, 2 panel discussions, 10 technical sessions, 5 Ignite talks, demos, and previews, and the most exciting of raffles, we at Sora Foundation are very excited to kick off SoraCon 2020. SoraCon brings together adopters, developers, and practitioners from different companies and industries to share and explore and collaborate openly. Engage with leaders from Sora projects and ecosystem participants and users, as well as other key open source projects such as Kubernetes, as we set the direction for the autonomous data management ecosystem. Let's get started with SoraCon 2020. With that, let me invite on your screens Mr. Steven Tan, Sora Board Chair, VP and CTO Cloud Solutions FutureWay, for the opening keynote. Over to you, Stephen.
Hi. Hello, everyone. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to SolarCon 2020. Let me share my screen.
Yes, Stephen, you can.
Yeah, we're able to see your screen, Stephen.
So 2020 has been a difficult year for many of us. In spite of this, we came together and launched Sora Foundation in June this year. There are many people that work very hard to make it happen, and I'm very thankful to each and every one of them. There's one person that I'd like to thank especially, but unfortunately, he is no longer with us. For anyone in open source, Dan is a familiar figure. Most people know him as the executive director of CNCF. Few people know him as the founder or GM of the Linux Foundation Public Health Organization that he started this year because of the COVID-19. I first met Dan when I proposed the OpenSDS project to Linux Foundation. OpenSDS is the predecessor to the Sora Foundation. Since that day, he has been a staunch supporter of this project, providing advice and guidance to us. We try to find time to talk whenever we are at conferences around the world, in Tokyo, in Shanghai, in Bengaluru, in Barcelona, Lyon, Seattle, and many other cities around the world. I have met him more times in the past few years than my boss, who is remote. Dan is our regular keynote guest speaker at our past events. He would always respond in a day with an enthusiastic yes, wherever I invite him to speak. So I was curious this time around when I didn't see a reply from him after sending an invitation. After a few days, after I sent the invite, I saw the news on Twitter talking about Dan passing away. So Dan is one of the key open source leaders of our time. At the same time, he's a family man who's always proud of his wife, Julie, and of his two kids, Adam and Alice. You can find out more about Dan's amazing life and his contribution to open source at the link below. In this link, there's also a college fund donation that's set up for these two kids, Adam and Alice. So for those who would like to find out more and contribute, please go check the link out. So 2020 is a special year for us. How will you remember it? Everyone will remember this for sure. And the endless Zoom meetings, and sometimes you can see kids running in the background, some of the colleagues camera. I'm waiting endlessly for all these food deliveries that come. They are always late. Catching our movies that we haven't got the time to watch in the past. And also browsing endlessly on the phone. All these activities have something in common. And that's all about data. So all this data run through the edge, AI, IoT, and all these other technologies, enabling us to work, eat, and relax during these endless lockdowns without us ever having to leave the house. But all this data needs to be stored, protected, governed, and controlled for different purposes. And the data control framework provides one or more of these functions. Data control frameworks are usually vendor proprietary, which may not be a bad thing. But this becomes a pain point when there are multiple frameworks in the architecture. For instance, it is a pain to move data between two vendor storage for people that know about it. And also to ensure data across different vendor frameworks, it's almost impossible. The result is data silos if the frameworks are not connected. So in the real world deployment, multiple frameworks is the norm, and working with them is a challenge. Multiple data silos may result if they are not managed well. Edge and cloud add to the management complexity. The solution we are proposing is an open data framework that's open source, unified, and autonomous, providing functions for storage, backup, lifecycle management, and more. Standard data policies act as the glue to unify all the different frameworks, and the framework leverage machine learning and automation to minimize human intervention. This open data framework solves challenges through open source innovation. So how do we do that? We do that through open source and open standard. So open source allows us to have open design and development. The base for this framework was created in the OpenSDS open source project back in 2017. The community developers have been working and publishing regular software releases. Our releases are named after islands in alphabetical order, starting from Zealand, Aruba, and to the late current release, Greenland. The next release is Hawaii, featuring performance anomaly detection, performance visualization, enhanced file shares for the different cloud services, and more. The source code is available on our GitHub. And today, there are sessions today and tomorrow covering all the different features and demo on the Greenland release as well as the Hawaii release. So please feel free to join all these different sessions. So standards organizations like SNEAR and IEEE devote vast amounts of time and resources defining specifications to standardize a broad range of technologies. including data and storage. SODA works with these organizations in two ways. First, to implement specifications that have been defined, such as NIST specifications and CSI container storage interface. And second, to enhance these specifications through our framework requirements. So in addition, we also work with regional and country, you know, national institutions such as the China Electronics Standards Institute and Cloud Computing Innovation Council of India to ensure the framework meets the requirements of each country or region. And we also source feedback from industry organizations like the Japan Data Storage Forum to make sure that whatever that we need, I mean, is fulfill their needs too. So we are honored to have speakers from all these different organizations at Protocon presenting today and tomorrow. So do check out their talks. So what defines SODA? So SODA is the home for data and storage projects. The SODA Incubator Program provides support for the development, growth, and adoption of projects. In addition to the Open Data Framework, the YIG project by China Unicom joined this incubator at the launch of SODA Foundation. And today, I'm also happy to announce that the Intel DALS project, which is a distributed asynchronous object storage project, has also joined the SODA family. So besides incubating projects, besides developing in the projects in the community and incubating projects that have been developed outside the community itself, we also actively seek out projects, open source projects that are out there and collab to seek and promote cross projects collaboration. So the three projects that you see up there, Linstore, OpenEBS, and Zencore are open source projects by our SODA members. And the rest are like Cinder is an OpenStack project, Jubal FS is a CNCF project, and Curve is an open source project by the company Netis. So we are also privileged to have speakers from each of these projects sharing with us the details of these two projects these 2 days. Please attend their talks to find out more about the projects. Later on, after me and Reddy, we'll also be highlighting the special features or about these projects. So SODA is also home for end users. End users is a big deal for any open source project. They act as validators to the project vision. In SODA, the End User Advisory Committee comprises representatives from around the world across different industries, as you can see here. The EAC allows us to focus on the needs of end users, both big and small, and it allows end users to share and address real-world issues together. SODA is also home for developers. The SODA Academy is a new program that we are coming up to help developers learn, grow, and lead. The Academy will be offering boot camps, internships, trainings, certifications, and bounties for developers beginning next year. So look out for our announcements in the next few months. SODA is where it is today because of everyone in the community who are passionate about open source. We are at many open source events around the world, and there are regular community meetups in different cities, although most of them are virtual this year. Our outreach committee chair, Larry Lai, will be sharing later today on what we are planning to do to support and grow the SODA community in the coming year. So SODA is a neutral forum for vendors, end users, standards bodies, and industry organizations to collaborate on data and storage. Together, we can address real issues that users face. We launched Soda Foundation with 22 organizations back in June. And since then, other companies like other organizations like Seagate and JDSF has joined us. And today I'm also honored to announce that CCICI and Guanghua Group has also joined Soda Foundation. And I invite all of you who are not members yet to join us and be a part of this open source innovation. And I forgot to mention that we also welcome Academia to join us as associate members. So Soda Foundation, join us. Thank you. Next, is Anjaneya Reddy Chagam. He is the Soda Foundation board member and chief architect of SDS at Intel. And most importantly, he's actually one of the, the person, one of the key people that actually started the OpenSDS project, which became the Soda Foundation. So, Reddy, please. I'll be your remote control.
All right, Stephen, thank you. Thanks for the intro. As Stephen talked about it, we have Soda Incubation Program. So our goal with the Soda Incubation Program is, obviously it's not easy for us to go develop all the functionality needed for the data management, that essentially covers the cloud, private cloud, public cloud, edge, and with different, features that are needed for the data management. So our goal is to essentially take advantage of the existing open source projects, whether it is the CNCF Foundation, the standalone open source projects, or any other foundation, in that regard. Our goal is to essentially take advantage of those projects, bring them under the umbrella of Soda Incubation, the focus, and create a very complementary set of, data management, focus areas that can actually, support the whole integration aspect of the Soda framework, and, essentially provide, some of the end user deployments very quickly to address the data management problems. So I will cover each one of them at a very high level. The intent is to kind of tee up, give you a flavor of why we chose these incubation projects as part of the Soda Incubation Program, give you the flavor of how these projects are actually complementary to each other. And then there are actually specific tracks where there are presenters for each one of these projects going over the technical details. So I strongly recommend you guys to attend those sessions to really understand the technical aspects of each one of these incubation projects. Next slide, Stephen. Okay, so the first one, so in general, when we look at the data management, we look at two distinct aspects of storage. One is the data plane aspect of the storage, the management. The other one is the control plane aspect of the storage. In the data plane, obviously you have file interface, object interface, block interface, key value interface. We are essentially looking at different storage backends that can actually bring in the data plane, the storage projects that are actually complementary. So if you look at Chubao FS, for example, it's a cloud native CNCF project. It provides a mechanism to bring in, it's a scale out storage that essentially exposes the storage either through the POSIX file semantics or S3 based object storage semantics, scale out, high performance, multi-tenant, the storage backend is what you get out of the Chubao FS storage platform. So that gives you essentially the file system and object storage. And then if you look at Deios that Stephen was introducing in the beginning, this is the new incubation project organically developed for delivering very high performance for emerging class of storage media. It could be NVMe SSDs, which is essentially the flash-based SSDs, or it could be storage class memory, like Intel Optane persistent memory or Intel Optane SSD. These types of media do require a software stack that is highly optimized from ground up. So Deos is one such example. It provides an object storage interface, key value interface, can exploit the really the high performance attributes of this storage media, and can deliver an extremely high performance, low latency, can scale to hundreds of nodes. So Deos is one such example where you can really take advantage of deploying a very high performance storage backend within the context of SODA. Next slide. Next slide, Stephen. It's not moving. Okay. So there are two other projects that provide, you know, data plane backends. YIG essentially can, today if you look at the, it takes advantage of, it essentially provides a scale out functionality on top of the existing Ceph storage cluster. So if Ceph has a, you know, a gateway called Rados Gateway that is that provides, you know, S3-based interface or Swift-based interface, object interface for the storage, you know, coming from a pool of Ceph storage nodes, which are called OSDs. Now, if you have, you know, whenever you have a Ceph storage cluster that is significantly large, you know, essentially get into, you know, scale challenges, especially if you have thousands of nodes. You get into, you know, a bunch of issues related to sharding, rebalancing, all the, you know, bucket sharding, lookups, and so on. In order to avoid, you know, scale challenges, you normally want to deploy a, you know, a cluster that is of some manageable capacity. Now, if you have multiple of those clusters, and how do you actually take the object interface constructs coming out of each one of those, you know, clusters, and, you know, create a very uniform namespace on top of that? YIG essentially provides a, you know, a storage gateway that manages the multiple Ceph storage clusters and provides the S3 interface on top of that. The Curve is essentially the new one in the incubation project. It's a high-performance block storage scale out. As you can see here, there is a metadata server that essentially gives you the flavor of, you know, where your, you know, the objects or files are located in a pool of servers. And then on the storage node, you have a chunk server, and you have essentially the, you know, the slices in the chunk server that provide, you know, a basic building block constructs to manage a storage media and a pool of servers, and then be able to actually replicate, rebalance all the, you know, typical scale out distributed storage properties and expose, you know, through the block storage interface. So if you look at from the previous slide and this slide, essentially these are all the data plane backends, you know, and you can cherry pick and choose based on your problem space. If you need a high performance, you have a choice. If you need a POSIX or S3 type of interface, you have a choice. And if you need to actually pool multiple, you know, the storage backend, you have a choice. To get to, you know, a specific deployment and use case you have in mind, we want to be able to support those different permutations and combinations to get to the, to address your data management problems. Now, if you look at the next slide, if you have the story, next slide. If once you have the storage backend that essentially give you the data plane to meet your performance, capacity, latency requirements, how do you manage them? So for example, you have lots of storage nodes in a data center, And some of them are actually exposed. The storage is actually exposed through, let's say, iSCSI volumes. Some of them are actually exposed through NVMe or Fabrics based interface, which is really an emerging low latency Fabrics oriented interface. How do you manage those pool of resources? You have a choice. Either you write drivers for each one of them, manage each one of those nodes on its own merit, or you can actually have a control plane management stack like Linstore that essentially pools all the storage resources on the pool of storage nodes, be able to actually consume them through, let's say, container-based orchestration like Kubernetes. So Linstore is one such example. Now, if you have virtual machines, and if you need virtual machine-based orchestration, you typically want to use Cinder. Cinder is a very popular block storage management project in OpenStack that has ability to plug in different storage backends. It has over 100 plus drivers, all the way from scale-up storage appliances to scale-out, you know, storage stacks as part of the Cinder driver framework ecosystem. So you can essentially take advantage of the existing Cinder effort and plug them into SODA framework through the incubation project effort. Now, next slide. Now, okay, so you have a data plane backend, and you have orchestration control plane, you know, software stacks. Now, typically in the existing emerging, most of the workloads in the emerging space, you may have certain data in the private cloud. You may have data in the public cloud. Even in the public cloud, you may have data in different CSP cloud infrastructure, you know, solutions. Now, and then of course you may have data in Edge as well. So how do you actually pool? How do you bring in the you know, seamless way of managing the data, irrespective of where your data is located, private, on-prem, public, Edge? You need a mechanism to get there. So there are two different storage stacks we have here. One is the OpenEBS. It's basically a Kubernetes-based framework that can actually manage any storage backend. You can provision the, you know, storage resources. You can actually replicate them among different storage backends, which could be, let's say, it could be sitting in the AWS, it could be in the Azure, it could be in the Google, GCP, or it could be DigitalOcean. You know, backend, irrespective of where it is located, you'll be able to actually manage them very transparently through OpenEBS framework. That essentially gives you the, you know, the block storage, you know, multi-cloud orchestration solution. Now, if you have S3 connectivity and you have storage, object storage actually, you know, distributed among multiple clouds, then Zenko.io essentially gives you a way to use S3 interface, be able to store any cloud that any cloud, either it is the on-prem or the public cloud, you can actually store them, you can replicate them among different cloud service providers, and you can actually manage all your object storage backends through one seamless interface. So that is Zenko.io. So these two essentially give you object as well as the block multi-cloud orchestration, you know, use cases. Next one. Here are the different, so I kind of covered data plane incubation projects, very high level, talked about control plane storage backends, and then also talked about the multi-cloud orchestration on how you actually stitch together both the data plane and the control plane, be able to actually manage data sitting in multiple clouds. There are a few talks that I mentioned in the beginning that you really want to attend to get insights into each one of these projects, get an idea of, you know, exactly how those projects can actually help you to address your use case needs, or you may want to contribute to these projects, or you may want to actually help us to the integration into the SODA framework. think there is one more slide. Here is the Zenko one. Cloud AD management using Zenko. The next one, Curve. This is the block storage, high performance distributed stack. It is the data management, essentially the ecosystem projects that talk about the data management challenges. And what's the next one?
And that's it.
That's it.
Okay, thank you, Reddy.
Steven, go ahead.
Yeah, thanks, Steven. So for the next talk, I'd like to invite our speaker, Yoshiya Ito-san. He is the Soda Foundation Advisory Board and a Linux Foundation Fellow, and also a Principal Architect at Fujitsu. So Ito-san.
Hi, Stephen. Thank you for kind introduction. My name is Yoshiya Ito, working for Fujitsu and supporting several open source projects also. I have been working in the open source communities and with open source communities for 20 years. In these 20 years, I have managed a dedicated open source development team for my business and have learned a lot from open source community. These are mainly from the difference of the development style or process between open source community and the proprietary software development. And some of them, what I learned may be useful for you. So today I would like to share the development model in the open source community that I really learned in my career. Next slide, please. So in the open source community, the development process is open to the public, of course. This is very unique compared with proprietary software development. Who contributes the code, what kind of code, and who reviews that code? And sometimes the result of QE may be open to the public. This development is not limited to product vendors, product developers, nor service providers, end users and service operators sometimes join this development process with their own investment, motivated by their own business. I think this is the most unique point compared with the proprietary software, ISV. Of course, you can request ISV about locked features for your business, but final investment decision will be made by the ISV vendors, of course. In the open source community, end user can directly invest to the code and features that will help the user's business growth. And it is possible because the development opportunity is also open to the public. And in this context, my question is, coding the source code or contributing the features, fixing the bug is only the development method? This is my question. 10 years ago or more years ago, very, very limited number of Japanese employee, Fujitsu employee, or Chinese employee, Korean, India employees can come to visit United States and attend the open source event. On the other hand, I had seen a lot of US end users come to talk with open source developers and maintainers about their business, not features, about their business. I have no idea what they are doing at that time. Event participation fee is not cheap, I think, probably $1,000 USD at that time. I'm not sure what they are doing at that time. Next page, please. Those end users did not contribute code to the community at that time. It looks like just saying a claim or claiming to the open source project. But later, I have learned that this is a kind of a development process in the open source. Here is a very typical famous example. Here is a photograph. His name is Vinod Kuti. He was a director at Chicago Mercantile Exchange platform. Chicago Mercantile Exchange is a world largest future trading market, and he was responsible for the platform side. And he came to talk at Kernel Summit, Linux Kernel Summit in 2008 and give a talk. What is happening in the market of platform operation? Or what really he is facing in the daily operation? I was shocked about this event. He is not coding a source, contributing a code at that time, but surely developing in the Linux community based on his real business and the real daily operation. And this is very unique development style, I think. Not a direct development, very indirect development style. However, very effective. That is based on his business and his daily operation. And surely he created several job opportunities also in the Linux community and the related communities. From that day, I have a dream that end users can come to give a talk to open source community developers and maintainers more often, more frequently, to input the real issues, what they are really facing, to the community maintenance and developers. So I created these kind of opportunities as the board director of Linux Foundation. However, most of them had gone, unfortunately, gone. But few are working very good and creating good outcomes. Next slide, please. Next page, please. In SOD foundations, end users, service operators are actively talking with their own POC and their demos in the community. And Japanese end users come to communicate with maintenance. And also from the vendor point of view, we can hear a very good input from the end users. Please come to join the SODA Foundation to develop mandatory features for your business. In this SODACON 2020, several end users, service operators, service providers will give a keynote and sessions. I'm very glad to hear their talk. Steven, thank you very much for giving me such a good opportunity to talk here and hear their talk. Thank you, Steven.
Thank you, Ito-san. Thank you for Ito-san is actually has been a staunch supporter of the SODA Foundation and OpenSS project also from the very beginning. So, and that's why we brought him on board to be an advisor for SODA Foundation. And we're really lucky to have Ito-san to, you know, advise us on all aspects of operations and so on. Thank you. So with that, this is the end of our keynote. Thank you. So we have a lot of great talks going on. After this, right after this, we have the speakers from all the different end user companies that you saw up there, like Yasawa-san from Toyota and so on will be speaking and so on. So, and then Larry will be sharing about the plans for the outreach and the community development. So please stay tuned, stay on this conference for the rest of the evening, morning, afternoons, and so on. Okay, thank you very much. Back to you,
Stephen, there's a question from one of the attendees.
Yes.
So Anunay Roy wants to know how real business operations can help open source community.
I didn't get you.
The question is how real business operations can help open source community.
Okay. I think Ito-san just answered, just presented and shared. He just answered the question. So businesses, the way they can actually help with this open source effort is that they can contribute. I mean, sponsorship is one of the thing. I mean, money. I mean, we always need money to do all kinds of activities and events. Having a champion inside an organization from a product, you know, or from a business, you know, to contribute in different ways in terms of like the end user kind of use cases that Ito-san mentioned, and from development kind of view. I mean, again, all this, basically Ito-san preempted your question. So Ito-san,
the foundation prepares end user seats, right?
Yes.
Yeah, right. So please join to SODA Foundation and give us a talk.
Right.
I have one more question. The standardization for different storage vendors is really hard. Is there any specific strategy for the same in SODA?
Has been trying to do that. SNIL has been doing that for years. I mean, and they've got all the big organizations in there. I mean, the top, you know, storage vendors are in there and so on. So it is hard, but so you know, so the problem with I would say the problem, but the multiple challenges. Okay, the standards bodies they have their goal is to, you know, align all the different specifications, you know, interoperability together and so on. Whereas, but the product teams within all these organizations, their goal is to make money. Okay, so it's not about trying to standardize or interoperate with stuff and so. So I think what we play, I mean, SODA Foundation has an interesting role in this, in the sense that we are an open, you know, open source kind of a collaboration. So actually we can actually implement stuff to make things work. So, and like what I mentioned, we need to work with standards bodies, you know, they've already defined stuff, we take the stuff, I mean, we things that make sense and then implement it and try to, you know, get all the vendors to support it. And one of the key aspects is end users. I mean, if there are no end users using something, I mean, nobody's gonna waste the effort to implement. So that's key. I mean, having end users, big end users, you know, especially to support the effort. Yeah.
Right.
Ito-san, do you wanna add stuff? I mean, you're on mute.
Recently, the open standard and open source is working very tightly. For example, ISO is accepting the several open source process as an open standard. So in the past, the open standard and implementation is different, has a different table and a different world. Our recent trend is standard and open source is come to sit on the same table and discuss among the real end users' issues through standard and implementation at the same time. That is a current technology trend, I believe.
Yeah.
All right. I think with that, I would like to thank Stephen. I would like to thank Engineer Reddy and Ito-san for their valuable time and this amazing keynote to kick off SoraCon 2020 day one. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.